Good day, YouTube. Welcome to math.serve.com. In this clip, we're going to be going over how to use the calculus of differential equations to understand the spread of an epidemic. So the one that's on the mind of many right now is Ebola. Okay? Do not forget to visit our website at math.serve.com for access to a wide variety of math tutorials, ranging from algebra all the way to calculus. So the hypothetical problem we're going to use to understand the spread of an epidemic using calculus is as follows. If a family of five are infected with Ebola, how long will it take to spread to 50% of LA's population? So let's assume that the family of five live in Los Angeles, that has a population of 3.8 million, how long will it take to get 50% of the population infected with this disease? Okay? All right, so what we're going to use today, we're going to be using the SIR model to basically understand the complexity of the situation. All right, so we're using the SIR model. Okay, there are other models that can be used to model the spread of an epidemic, known as the stochastic model, but this is the model that we're going to be using today. So the SIR model basically involves dividing up the population into different groups or compartments. Okay, so you might wonder, what does SIR mean? Well, SIR basically represents the three functions that are basically used to define the rate at which the different variables or functions change when we are looking at the spread of a disease. Okay, so let's go ahead and explain what this word SIR means. S, the first letter, represents a function. Okay, so this function tells you the number of people that are susceptible or yet to be infected by the epidemic. Okay, so let's call this number of people susceptible or yet to be infected. Okay? All right, we have the S down. The next letter in the SIR acronym is I. I of t, this function represents the number of people that are infected with the disease. Okay, so I represents number of people infected. Okay, and then lastly, R. R of t is a very interesting function. R of t represents the number of people that have recovered from the outbreak with immunity. Okay, so number of people that have recovered with immunity. Okay. So immunity is important here because if you recover from the disease and you're still susceptible, then you're classified as an S in the equation. But if you recover with immunity, then you are classified as being R of T, okay? Now another group of people that fall into the R of T group is the people that basically passed away as a result of the infection and are not exposed to infect others, okay? So R of T represents those who recovered with immunity, and it also includes those who passed away as a result of the infection and are not in a position where they can infect others. Okay, so this SIR model can be used to generate an equation that basically groups everybody in the population sample into their respective categories, okay? So the equation is N equals S plus I plus R. Okay, so there you have the SIR. Now, you might wonder, what is N? Well, N represents the total number of people in the population area that you're looking at. Okay, so in this case, in this problem, we're looking at Los Angeles, for example. So N is going to be 3.8 million, or the total number of people living in Los Angeles. Okay, so let's put that here. N of T is total population. Total population. Now, in order for us to answer this question, how long does it take for 50% of people in Los Angeles to get infected with this disease? We need to know how fast the disease spreads, okay? The rate of infection. So that's what we need to know. So if the rate of infection were 3.8 million people in a week, then we know that in half a week, 50% of the population will get infected with Ebola. Okay, so how fast does it spread? If we can determine the rate of spread, then we can tell exactly how long it will take for half of the population to get infected. Okay, so taking a look at this equation right here, we're going to differentiate this equation implicitly. Okay, and we're looking for the rate at which the infection function changes. Okay, so that's what we're going to be solving for. We're differentiating implicitly because we're looking for the instantaneous change of the infected function with respect to time. And this function is not solved explicitly for I. So we're just going to differentiate implicitly. Okay, so we're going to find the derivative with respect to time of the entire equation. N equals S plus I plus R. Remember, these three are functions of time. So if we differentiate implicitly, we're going to have, this is a constant, the population is a constant, so that will be zero. We have zero equals ds dt plus di dt plus dr dt, okay? But we're looking for the rate of infection. So let's isolate the idt, because this function represents the rate of infection. So we'll simply subtract the sdt and the rdt from both sides of the equation. And then isolating the idt, we're going to have the idt equals negative ds dt minus dr dt. Okay, now some really smart mathematicians came up with what these functions ds dt and dr dt represent, and these mathematicians are known as Kermack and McKendrick. Okay, so all this is based on a theory that they came up with. So let's go ahead and write down what their name is. Kermack. This is what this theory is known as today. So Kermack and - McKendrick theory. Okay. So according to them, we can specify what ds dt and dr dt are. So the ds dt is equal to negative beta S I, and the RDT is equal to gamma times I. All right, so the SDT again represents the instantaneous rate of change of the number of people that are susceptible. And we can see that it's negative because when there's an outbreak, the number of people that are susceptible keeps falling. Okay, so this is a negative growth because people are, you know, falling out of this group. Okay, and then this is the RDT is the instantaneous rate of change of the number of people that have recovered with immunity. This is positive because after people get infected and they recover, this group of the population, they grow in number, all right? So that's what we have here. But what we're looking for is the IDT, which is the instantaneous rate of change of the number of people infected, or how fast the infection is spreading. All right, so all I'll simply do here is substitute these values, these two values, into this equation that we have up here. So we'll have the I dt equals negative ds dt. We know that that's beta times s times I, minus dr dt, which is gamma times I. So we'll just simplify this, and then we'll end up with the infection equation. Okay, so di dt equals negative beta s I minus gamma I. Right, so just to make sure we understand what's going on, let's go ahead and label the functions that we have here. The s dt equals bsi is known as the susceptible equation. So this is the susceptible equation, instantaneous rate of change of those people who are susceptible to the disease. And then the RDT is known as your recovered equation. Remember that recovery means you recovered with immunity. If you don't have immunity, you fall into this category, okay? And then the one that we're looking for, the IDT, this is known as the infection, or the infected equation, okay? Infected equation. All right, so just to show you how complex this situation is, let's go ahead and specify what beta and gamma represent, okay? All right, so these are the other functions that we highlighted earlier. Now, what are we going to add to this list is beta and gamma, as I indicated earlier. So beta basically represents the contacts per day, okay? So beta represents contacts per day. All right, what does this mean? This means that the number of contacts that can result in the transmission of the infection, that's what counts as a contact. So a contact that cannot result in the spread of the disease does not count as a contact, okay? And then 1 over gamma represents the average infection, the average infectious period, okay? How long does someone stay infectious to the disease? How long can someone infect others? So that's the average infectious period. Okay? And then T, the independent variable, of course, is the number of days. All right, so with all this information, let's go back to the original question that we posed. So the original question was, how long was it going to take 50% of LA's population to contact Ebola at 5 if a family of 5 are infected? Well, the answer to the question is as follows. It's almost impossible. Almost impossible to accurately predict. So you might wonder, why is it almost impossible to accurately predict? Well, let's drop down to what we have here. Now, what we have here is a system of differential equations, okay? And in order to solve this, we need some really powerful computers such as Mathematica or Wolfram Alpha to solve it. And then they can generate different models. But the models that they generate are very hypothetical. There are a lot of assumptions that have to be made in whatever solutions that you can come up with for this differential equation. Why do you have to make a lot of assumptions? Well, look at how many functions your differential equation is dependent upon. So any of these can change at any time. For example, you can have five infected people that get quarantined, or they can pass away. So it's hard to. So this number automatically changes. You can also have other changes. For example, a change in population. People might migrate away from the area, or the disease might mutate into another form, which might alter the rate at which it gets transmitted. So there are so many variables in the function that makes it extremely difficult to accurately predict how fast any epidemic can spread. Okay, so for the case of Ebola, it's very difficult because there are way too many variables that can change at any point in time, which makes it almost impossible to accurately predict how fast the disease is going to spread. Okay, so that's that. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this presentation. We really appreciate it. Feel free to subscribe to our channel for updates to other cool tutorials such as this. More clips can be found on math.serve.com. And also feel free to post a comment in the comment section to let us know what you think about this tutorial. Thanks again for watching and have a wonderful day.